One, some of you might not know if you started coming along recently, we serve coffee every Sunday morning. We've got a professional coffee machine there and some professional baristas that are getting really good at their job. So that's between sort of 9 o'clock to 9:15 we're serving coffee. So if you get up 15 minutes earlier and you can count on that with a bit of caffeine, and it'll keep you awake in the sermon too. The trivia night, that's coming up about a month. So it's going to be 7 o'clock on the 10th of September. It's going to be a good fun night. If you're not into trivia, come along anyway. There's going to be some good desserts and there'll be lots of fun. If it's not an outreach event as per se, but if you've got people in your life that you've been sharing the gospel with or thinking about inviting along to church, it's a good opportunity to bring them along, get them to meet the rest of us, get familiar with where we do meet. It's a good opportunity there to consider. We will be running a kids program. The evening will run from sort of 7 till about 9:30, 10 o'clock, so we realise that's a bit late for kids, but if you aren't able to get babysitters or if you're keen to just bring them along and they don't mind a little bit of a late night, then bring them along. Just when you RSVP, so RSVP to me, my details are in that staying in touch and on that screen, my email address or phone number. Just let us know if you're bringing kids and what ages they are so that we can kind of cater some activities for them. Also, if you're bringing, you don't need to get a table together as such, just let us know we're coming and we'll spread everyone out. If you're bringing friends from outside the church, just let us know that and so we can sit you with them as well. I think that's all on the trivia night. Oh yeah, just and RSVPs, so we don't really need an RSVP till sort of that Sunday before, but if you know you're coming, let me know because early RSVPs make it easy for us to organise things. Finally, we've got a camping trip planned on the, so it's the 22nd to 24th of September. So I've booked out Friday's campground. I've still got about 3 sites left there. It's $30. If that doesn't fit your budget, don't worry about it. And it's, so that's the grand final weekend. So it's the grand final public holidays on the Friday. So we're camping a Thursday, Friday night, which means if you are interested in the footy, which I don't think there's any chance of any good teams playing in the grand final, but you will have time to pack up on the Saturday and get home. Any questions, just let me know or speak to any of the events teams members, which is Seven Esther and Kevin Mel and myself and Kathy. Thanks, guys.
Well, good morning. Welcome to you all this morning. Phil, so if we're not into trivia, but we'd like to take advantage of just dropping the kids off before we go out to dinner, that'll be okay too? Yeah. My name's Darren. Welcome to you. If you're just visiting, out through the double doors, you'll find the cry room and toilets. And just a reminder that after the service, we will be having a morning tea, so please stay around and chat and get to know people during that time. Thanks to Phil, you know all the information that you need to know. I would just encourage you in the coming weeks to be praying for those men who will be preaching. Obviously, most of you know I'm going on a couple of months holiday. So I was looking at Daniel as if I was going to say, Daniel, I'm just going to drop you in it, but you're not. Rich is going to do the bulk of the preaching, but he'll also be assisted by Steve Gray, who will be preaching a couple of times, and also Ben Duncanson. So be praying for those men and their preparation. Well, we've gathered to worship the Lord, and I'm going to call you to worship from those well-known verses in the book of Revelation. And here is John, and he's giving a picture of what worship looks like for those who have died, been called home, but yet before the general resurrection. And so it's placed in heaven. And we're told that in verse 8 of Revelation 4, and the 4 living creatures, each of them with 6 wings, full of eyes all around and within. And day and night, they never cease to say, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. And whenever the living creatures give glory and honor and thanks to him who is seated on the throne, who lives forever and ever, the 24 elders fall down before him who is seated on the throne and worship him who lives forever and ever. They cast their crowns before the throne saying, "Worthy are you, our Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power, for you created all things, and by your will they existed and were created." Well, that's why we gathered here this morning, because the Lord has made us, but he's also redeemed us. And so we gather to worship Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Let's pray. Our Father, we thank you that we can have these pictures of adoration and praise, and thanksgiving in the heavens, of where angelic beings and glorified men and women and boys and girls gather to worship your name, where they acknowledge you for who you are, and they praise you for your great power, but also your holiness. And they bow before you, and they praise and worship your name. Well, we want to do that this morning. We often become so familiar with you, we can forget that we worship and serve a holy God, a God who is not only without sin, but a God who is full of righteousness and always does what is good and right and lovely and true, and we do not. And that's why we need your grace. We need that gospel grace that comes in the Lord Jesus, that grace that invites us to confess our sin to the one who is faithful and just, that gospel grace that promises to take our sins from us as far as east is from west, and remove our shame and replace it with the joy of your salvation, to know no condemnation for those in Christ Jesus. Well, help us to know that this morning. Help us by the power of your Spirit to be convicted of our every failing, our every sin, our every good work left undone, and yet be reminded that Christ is sufficient. His blood cleanses. Your Spirit renews, recalibrates, and refreshes. And we pray that would be true of every one of us this morning. And that something of that joy of your salvation will be evident in the way that we sing, in the wholeheartedness of our worship, in our attentiveness to your words, and in the purposes of our hearts to serve and obey you. For we ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, let's stand and we'll sing our first song of praise this morning. To God be the glory. Thank you.
right, up the front, kids. Let's do some kids cat. Morning, everyone. My name's Phil. I'm going to be teaching you our commandment for today. Does anyone remember what our Ten Commandments are? Should we go over them from the start, up to where we are? Who remembers what the first commandment is? Oh, I've got the wrong page. Who can remember the first commandment? Just yell it out. You know it? One God, very good. What about the second commandment? Don't worship idols. Yell it out. If you know it, just yell it out. Who knows the finger things? Yeah, you know the finger things. Good on you. What's the third? What's the third? What do you do? Don't lie. Or close. Go. Yell it out. Yes, don't misuse the name of the Lord your God. Very good, Gus. What's the fourth? I don't know what the finger thing is for the fourth. Yes, keep the Sabbath day holy. Very good. What's the fifth? One of the most important. Yeah, good job. Honor your father and mother. What's the sixth? Yeah, don't stab yourself. I reckon a good one for the sixth is make a gun out of those five fingers and shoot this guy. Reckon? Yep, don't murder. Good job. And the seventh, that's the one we did last week. It was a hard one for Mr. McGilvery. I don't know what the thing is. It's the adultery. Yes, don't commit adultery. Good job. And today, it's a much easier one. It's the eighth one. Do we know what that is? Who knows it? Yell it out. Shall not steal. Yeah, you asked me beforehand. That's why you know. So Mr. McGilvery had a really hard one last week, didn't he? And today, we've got a really easy one, a fun one. That's what we call God pouring out his blessings on the righteous. All right. So I reckon you guys all know what stealing is, don't you? Do you all know what stealing is? Yeah, so we almost don't need to do this one. But we'll have a bit of fun with it instead. Can you put that poster up for us, Steve? Do you know what a person that steals stuff's called? Called a thief. And we have a thief. We've got an international criminal amongst us. But you know what? We were going to arrest him today, and I think someone tipped him off because he didn't come to church. I think he's watching us at home. So you got away with it, Mr. Sabiot. But fortunately for us, we're in Victoria. And do you know what that means? Means we've got a corrupt, politicized police force. So we can arrest whoever we want for the crime. So I was thinking maybe we'll arrest one of the new dads that's going to start doing catechism soon. What do you reckon? Is that a good idea? Yeah? I reckon there's a few new dads out there that are a little bit nervous at the moment, hoping we don't pick them. But I've got someone good in mind, I think. Rory, do you reckon we'll get your dad? Your dad? No, your dad's an old head at catechism. That's no good. I reckon we'll get your dad. Can you go arrest your dad for me? Can you do that for me? We'll get you someone to help you. Who wants to help? Rory. Yeah. You know what? We'll get one more person, and then I'll get you all to help. With a hat on, because you were really good at your questions. Come on, help Rory. Rory will show you who he is. So can you go up and get your dad? You can help soon. But follow Rory. Yep, I'll get you up soon. You stay here. When we get him up the front, we'll bring him over there. Oh, he's going to run away. Get him. Got him. Good job. Good job. All right. Can you bring him over here for me? And I'll show you how we arrest people. All right. Good job. All right. Keep him there. Stick him up with your gun. Have you got a gun? Can you do that, Rory? Yeah, hands up. Hands in the air. Hands in the air. We're going to take his glasses off so we don't break them. This is going to get fun. All right. I reckon we might need you all up. Everyone come up. Come on. Come and help. All right. You can be our communicator and everyone else is around him. So get around him. Make sure he's not going to go anywhere. That's the way. All right. Good job. All right. So can you make a gun with your hand like that? All right. And we say, drop to your knees. Drop to your knees. Good job. All right. Now lay on your belly. Lay on your belly. Palms to the sky. Palms to the sky. God, you're good at this. You're really good at this. All right. Now, we need to get control of them, all right? So can you grab this hand and bring it around here? So kneel down here.
Kneel, put one knee either side of his hand. Yep. And I'll pull his fingers back like that. Yep. Yep. And so twist it the other way. That's it. Yep. Good job. All right. Now we need someone else who's a bit of a... Yep. All right. So when you come down here, put a kneel on his Achilles. And you go, oh. Now if you do that really hard, he goes, oh. And this leg pops up. And then you grab this leg and put it across to that knee. All right. And then you put this foot on that knee and take this one off. And then lift this one up. All right, and that's called a figure four, all right? So then jump around here, yep, and put your knees down here, or one knee either side, that's it, and put a bit of pressure on there. All right, good job. All right, we've got them all under control now. You guys are good cops. You're really good at this. Have you done this before?
Yeah.
All right, last bit, we got to put these on them. These are real ones, yep. So we got to bring this hand up behind his back. We'll see how flexible he is. We'll confiscate that. There you go, you can have that. That's the perks of being a police officer. All right, put those on. Click this one. Then we bring the other one up. Put that on. Good job. All right, now he is arrested. Now, there's one more thing we have to do. Well, do you remember what his crime was? He was stealing chocolate money. That was on the poster, so we've got to plant the evidence on him. There we go. All right, well done. Good job. Now we're going to get him up, put him on his knees. You can keep that. All right, so two people hold his arms here, and he said, all right, on three, you're going to go to your knees. One, two, three, to your knees. There we go. Ah, good job. Well done, guys. You were really good at that. All right, everyone back in their seats. We'll leave him there. Good job. You guys did that really well. I mean, you might have a few police officers when you grow up, yeah? All right, jump back in your seats. So what happens to him next? We caught him for stealing. He's got to go to jail, doesn't he? Pay his penalty because he broke the law. What law did he break? He broke the Australian laws, didn't he? We have laws that say you're not allowed to steal in Australia, so we arrested him. And he goes to jail. What else? What other law? Yep. Like I said, it's Victoria. So what other law? What's the law we're learning about? What's the law we're learning about today? Who remembers what our commandment is today? Yep, Riley. You shall not steal. Yeah, so he broke God's law as well. So, yeah, I've got a whole lot of chocolate money, so you can... You can all have a chocolate money at morning tea time, all right? I've got plenty out there for you to all have one. So he broke God's law as well. And does he go to jail for breaking God's law? Nah, why not? What happens? Well, he believes in Jesus, doesn't he? And Jesus has already paid the penalty for his sin. So he just needs to repent. And Jesus has already paid that penalty. So that's good, isn't it? All right, so do you remember what our eighth commandment is? You shall not steal. Yeah, good job. All right, we're going to pray and then we're going to sing our song. We've actually got a video for our song today, so that's going to be lots of fun. All right, let's bow our heads, fold our hands, and we'll pray. Lord, we thank you for your word. We thank you for these children, Father. We thank you for your commandments and that we can learn how to live. We pray that you would be with us, help us to persevere and to strive to be more and more like Jesus. We thank you for Jesus and that he has paid the penalty for our sins. His name we pray. Amen. All right, we've got a video.
Misuse God's name. Worship and rest. Honor.
sorry parents, this will bring God fame. When you keep the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, the 10 commandments, you'll discover how to love God and each other. By God's grace, you're gonna fly. When you keep the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, the 10 commandments, you'll discover how to love God and each other if you keep the 10 commandments. God first, no idols, don't misuse God's name. Worship and rest, honor your parents. No murder, no adultery. Don't steal, don't lie, don't covet. This will bring God fame. When you keep the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, the 10 commandments, you'll discover how to love God and each other if you keep the 10 commandments. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, the 10 commandments.
Good morning. So today we're reading from Luke 5, verses 1 to 11. On one occasion, while the crowd was pressing in on him to hear the word of God, he was standing by the lake of Gennesaret, and he saw two boats by the lake, but the fishermen had gone out of them and were washing their nets. Getting into one of the boats, which was Simon's, he asked him to pull out a little from the land. And he sat down and taught the people from the boat. And when he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, "Push out into the deep and let down your nets for a catch." And Simon answered, "Master, we toiled all night and took nothing. But at your word, I will let down the nets." And when they had done this, they enclosed a large number of fish, and their nets were breaking. They signaled to their partners in the other boat to come and help them. And they came and filled both the boats, so that they began to sink. But when Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees, saying, "Depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord." For he and all who were with him were astonished at the catch of fish that they had taken. And so also were James and John, sons of Zebedee, who were partners with Simon. And Jesus said to Simon, "Do not be afraid. From now on, you will be catching men." And when they had brought their boats to land, they left everything and followed him.
Well, let's take a moment to pray, and then we'll hear from God's word. Father, we thank you that you have given us your word and your spirit, that you have granted to us together with your church so that you might speak to us, glorify your son, build up your church and equip us for right thinking and fruitful service. To this end, we would commend ourselves to you this morning, praying that you would use the weakness of the flesh and the preaching of the word to build up your church and to bring honor to your son. To this end, we would pray for hearts and minds that love you and desire to be conformed through the proclamation of your words. So we ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Whenever I'm preparing someone for marriage, a young couple, I often try to paint a picture of what the biblical picture of marriage is compared to, say, perhaps a secular view of marriage. And I often picture it as two rivers, and that what marriage does is enable them to become one river. Not two parallel rivers running side by side, heading in the same direction, but two rivers that actually, through marriage, become one river. Or if you picture it as paths, one vision of a married life pictures a husband and wife having separate but parallel lives. And perhaps, you know, at various points in their marriage, and they're going to be doing things together, but there's allowance also for having a sort of an autonomous life. And of course, the danger of that vision of two people having, in a sense, two separate lives is that you might end up on different paths and you know, separating from one another, just metaphorically and perhaps even in reality. And yet the biblical vision, this other vision of marriage, would picture the husband and the wife journeying on the same path, walking the same road with the same purpose and with the same destination. They'll have shared income, values, and physical commitments. And while there may be different secondary interests, the vision of marriage speaks of this sort of unity of male and female in both vision and, of course, in purpose. Well, as it is in marriage, so it is in the Christian life. There's actually competing visions of what it looks like to follow Jesus. Differing visions, even within the church, of what it looks like to be a disciple of Jesus. See, some imagine that you can follow Jesus at a distance, or perhaps on occasion, or even at your own convenience. Sort of like, you know, like when you use you're heading somewhere and you use Google Maps. You firstly, with Google Maps, you use it when it suits you, when it's convenient. And second, with Google Maps, you always deserve the right to overrule it, right? So it'll say you should turn here, but you go, oh, no, that's dumb. I'll go here. And then you do a U-turn, come back and go where it told you to go. But there's not a point. But the point is you have this right to overrule. Some people, some churches, sort of imagine following Jesus is a bit like following Google Maps, that in some way that the Google Maps, like Jesus, there to serve, assist, and help you. And when it suits you to obey, when it's agreeable to follow, when it's convenient, then yeah, you might do that. You might serve, you might obey, you might follow. Maybe, you know, Bible study on a Wednesday night, might be at church on a Sunday morning, maybe be committed in all things at some point, at some place. Maybe someday. That's one vision of the Christian life. It's a popular vision. It permeates most denominations, lots of congregations. And it dovetails with a cultural view of autonomy. You know, that we can do our own thing and march to our own beat. So it's attractive. And then, of course, there's the biblical vision of the Christian life, where following Jesus is supposed to calibrate your loves, it controls your choices, it forms and actually transforms your life, whether it's convenient or not, whether it's kosher or not, whether it's costly or not. And you see, that's the picture that Luke is painting for us in his gospel this morning. He's picturing for us what it looks like to follow Jesus. He's, in a sense, joining the dots of what does a life of faith actually look like. And And the idea is that while it is both confronting, it's also compelling. And you're supposed to, as you read through the text of Luke 5, 1 to 11, you're supposed to ask the question, is that what my Christian life looks like? Is that how I picture the Christian life? Is that how I model the Christian life? If we ask your kids or your grandkids, probably that's a better starting point. We'll ask them, is that how mum or dad or granddad or grandma or pops or whatever you name yourself, is that how they picture you living out the Christian life? Boy, that would be confronting, wouldn't it? And see, by the end of this message, you need to answer that question, whether you're 70 or 7. And so the story opens up with Jesus teaching the crowd, and everyone's gathering. They're at the Lake of Gennesaret, and remember, we already saw from last week, that's why Jesus came. He came to proclaim that the kingdom of God is at hand. And so the text says, verse 1, on this occasion. And so on this occasion when he's teaching, because he's always teaching. On this occasion when he's teaching, the crowd is growing and it is pressing in. And there is this, at least perceived, eagerness to hear God's word. They're keen to listen to him teaching. And the crowd gets so large and presses in so hard that Jesus looks around. Verse 2 says that he saw two boats by the lake, but the fishermen had gone out of them and they were washing their nets. It's a perfect platform, literally keeping the crowd at bay and yet actually enabling them to remain close, enabling Jesus to be heard. I mean, water carries sound. In fact, it amplifies it. And no doubt, as we get this picture in Luke, there are people there who are genuinely curious. They want to hear what Jesus has to say. No doubt there are others who are sort of basically religious rubbernecking, and they're just looking for the next miracle. We've heard stories, and they're just hoping to see something. Verse 3 says that getting into one of the boats, which was Simon's, he asked him to put out a little from the land, and he sat down and taught the people from the boat. And note how the boat becomes both the place and the instrument of evangelism here. How, well, what is essentially a place of work, how it becomes a place to speak about Jesus and his kingdom. Here is Jesus utilizing what Peter owns for his own purposes. And it's not the main point of the text, obviously, but let me just say this. It is expected, it is anticipated that your possessions will serve the kingdom of God. If a fisherman's boat can be sequestered here, and so too your homes and your holiday homes, your bank accounts and your investment, anything can and in fact should be available for the kingdom, in a sense, platforms of all sorts. Jesus commandeers not just your life, but actually your platforms and your possessions. I wonder if you grapple with that as part of the gospel. That your work and that your home and that your possessions, these can actually, can and should be platforms for the gospel. Ought to be available for kingdom work. I wonder if young people, it'd be good if you understood that even now. You don't probably have too many platforms when you're young. Certainly don't have many possessions that you own. But as you mature, as you cultivate careers, as your laboring produces material fruit, perhaps gives you a useful platform, then Christ will expect to use you and it for his glory. You need to understand that even now, even as you set out in life, you understand that all you own and have and are is Christ. I realize that's a challenge for many of us. And if we're honest, we're failing in this challenge. especially if you're the sort of person who likes to keep, you know, separate compartments. You're sort of imagining letting Jesus in through the front door and then just sort of giving him limited access into the lounge, maybe the kitchen. Maybe you imagine him sort of like a spiritual border in your home. You know, it's still your home and still your rules. It's still your call. Except here in the Gospels, Jesus is never pictured like a border or a tenant. He's always portrayed as the landowner, the proprietor, the owner. That's because through the Gospel, he has bought you and possessed you and redeemed you, and he owns you. And all your possessions and all your platforms are his. You understand that, right? That's what it means to follow him. So let's assume we're all on the same page there. Look at verse 4. And when he had finished speaking, in other words, when the sermon has ended, when the crowds have finally dissipated, he then turns to the fishermen, to the blokes who are around him, and he turns to Simon and he says, "Put out into the deep, let down your nets for a catch." And Simon answered, "Master, we've toiled all night and took nothing." In other words, "Lord, Master, we're fishermen, you're a carpenter. We have already been out all night and we have come back empty-handed, and we've been out in the best conditions when it's dark and the fish don't see the nets. And we've come back with empty nets. And I've no doubt when they come back feeling tired and dejected. It had been a long, fruitless night. And then they'd got back only then to roll up to Bible study for another hour or two. And all they want to do is wash their nets and go home for a sleep." And then the carpenter says, "Push out into deep waters, put out your nets for a catch." You know how you get, it's a command, but it also comes with a promise. It's not like Jesus saying, "Let's go out into deep water, put down the nets, and let's see what happens." But Jesus is saying, "Obey me, there will be a catch." It's a test of their faith, because after a long night of futile fishing, could have easily have responded, "But I'm too exhausted. It's a waste of time. Already done it. Maybe next time." And yet the text tells us that Simon's response is, but at your word, despite the fact we've already done this, despite the fact we've come out empty-handed, despite the fact we're exhausted, despite the fact that the nets aren't clean, but at your word, I will let down the nets. I will do, I will go, I will obey." It's exactly what Noah said when he built the ark. It's what Abraham said when he went on an unknown journey. It's what Moses said when he led Israel in an Exodus. What Joshua said as he marched the people around Jericho. It's what Rahab said when she hid the spies. It's what all those who say, who follow Jesus, "But at your word." So Simon Peter says, "But at your word I will let down the nets." Because his faith must work. That if he believes, he's still got work to do. The fish are not going to jump into the boat by themselves. Well, they could, but not in this occasion. Jesus expects Peter to let down the nets, just in the same way as he expects you and I to let down our nets. You know, probably one of the main reasons our prayers go unanswered, because we don't let down the nets. Listen, without God, we can't, but just generally speaking, without us, he won't. Not can't, but won't. Letting down your nets is pivotal to actually being used and blessed of God, especially if you've previously already had empty nets. The whole idea is what God is doing. He's teaching them, and he's training them, and he's equipping them, and he's building their gospel resilience. He's teaching them how to be courageous in resolve, so that when marriages or parenting is tough, even when you've had a whole season, a whole period of time of emptiness, at least that's how it feels. At Jesus' word, that you are willing and you are ready to put down the nets. Could be after a season of being unloved or unpopular, maybe even unemployed, maybe unsuccessful, perhaps unappreciated. But at our Lord's word, you put down the nets. And remember how it's both the command, but it comes with a promise. The command is put down your nets. The promise is there's going to be a catch. Look at verse 6 and 7. That confirms it. And when they had done this, when they had done what Jesus commanded them to do, despite coming back empty-handed, they enclosed a large number of fish, and their nets were breaking. They signaled to their partners. Can you imagine the excitement and the flurry of activity? And they signaled to their partners in the other boat to come and help them. And they came and they filled both the boats. So that actually began to sink. And so here is Peter and all of his mates. And this is, for a fisherman, this is living the dream. This catch is so emphatic, the nets can't even cope. They're actually breaking as they're trying to pull them up, and as getting the others to help them pull in this catch. But even when they get it in, the boats are so overwhelmed with weight that they begin to sink. There is more fish than they could have asked for or even imagined. But it's not just the nets and the boats that are overwhelmed. Peter's overwhelmed. Look at verses 8 to 10. But when Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees, saying, "Depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord." For he and all who were with him were astonished at the catch of fish that they had taken. And so also were James and John, sons of Zebedee, who were partners with Simon. So here is Peter, presumably knee deep in fish, and he's literally blown away. He's astonished by the catch. It was more than he could have asked or imagined. In fact, the word translated astonished means actually fearful. It's usually translated as afraid. He saw this catch, and then it dawned on him, who is this bloke in the boat with us? And he was just gripped with fear. You know, back in the day, for Peter, a good day would have been 30, maybe 100 fish, and they just pulled in thousands of fish. And they just all look at each other, what just happened? How did we do that? And the truth is, Peter, like all the rest of them, he's just like us. You know, we sort of expect our man-sized solutions and are blown away by God-sized miracles. And so he is filled with this godly fear, gripped by it, astonished, doesn't do the word justice. He's actually trembling with fear because of who it is that it might be in this boat with him. And he's very reminiscent in his response of Isaiah, which we picked up in our reading from Call to Worship from Revelation 4. Remember when Isaiah gets a vision in Isaiah 6 of Yahweh, as soon as he sees God in the temple, he says, "Woe to me, woe to me. I am ruined because I am a man of unclean lips and I live among a people of unclean lips, and my eyes have seen the King, the Lord Almighty." Well, that could be true of any of us, for we are all people of unclean lips amongst the people of unclean lips. And so here is Peter, and He responds similar to Isaiah. He gets a glimpse of Jesus' true identity, and it just fills him with fear. And yet Jesus doesn't leave him in that fear. Look how Jesus responds. He says, and Jesus said to Simon, do not be afraid. From now on, you'll be catching men. And when they had brought their boats to land, they left everything and followed him. Here is Peter. He recognized, like Isaiah, that woe am I am undone. I'm undone because I know I'm a sinful man, and I'm just starting to work out that I'm in the presence of a holy God. And here is Jesus assuring him of that grace. Do not be, notice how he doesn't say, do not be astonished, do not be afraid. And then he reorientates him. And from now on, instead of catching fish, you will be catching men. From now on, you're going to march to my drumbeat. From now on, you're going to go where I send, and you're going to do what I say. And again, notice how they respond at Jesus' word. They obey. And then just like that, have a new occupation, a new calling as disciples of Jesus. And the text notes, with no fanfare, they leave everything. The boat hits land and they leave everything and they follow him. Indeed, one day not too far into the future, after Jesus' death, resurrection and ascension, Acts 2 records that Peter's very first sermon results in a catch of over 3,000 men. That's true that we're not called to be apostles. Apostles were by definition foundational, Ephesians 2:20. They're the foundation of the church. They bring to us, like the prophets, the scripture. But on them we build the church, on the teaching of Jesus and the apostles. But we are like the apostles because we too are sent ones. And we like the apostles because we too have been given both a command and a promise by Jesus in Matthew 28 that we will go make a catch of men and women, boys and girls, that we will make disciples of all the nations. And so it seems to me that what Luke is trying to do here is paint a picture of what it would look like for the church to follow Jesus. What it entails, what it encapsulates to be a disciple. Where faith says, at your word, at your word. Where repentance says, depart from me, recognizing my sin. Where discipleship entails leaving everything and following him. See, to be his disciple means you're going to have a life which is shaped and ordered and prioritized by Jesus. Where at his word, this is simple to say, this is so harder to do, but at his word, you repent and believe. Where at his word, your platforms and your possessions are utilized for him. Where at his word, even after a lonely, hard, empty season, at his word, you put down your nets. So how is that looking for you? Is that how you picture your Christian life? And if so, if that's right, does your life, if you were asked those close to you, family, friends, church members, does your life really say at your word? Does it? If we ask those around you, at your word. At your word, Lord, I'll go. At your word, I'll give. At your word, I'll obey. At your word, my life will be yours. At your word, if you say, I'm to marry a believer, I'll marry a believer. At your word, if you say, do not have sex outside of marriage, do not watch pornography, do not be greedy, do not be materialistic. At your word, Lord, I would obey. Because that's what it looks like. That's what he's saying. are your possessions and platforms and areas of your life, are they there for his use? Ask yourself, is my career, my marriage, sex, life, home, is that for his glory? Are they platforms for his word? What about your time and your energy, your money, your reputation? What about an attitude or a disposition or a character or temperament? And more than that, part of discipleship is actually learning to put down your nets when God tells you to. Even if you've had a season of empty nets. In fact, it's usually after a season of empty nets, when nothing's working, where there's no evident fruit, when you're sort of discouraged or exhausted, a season where God is happy to let you fail and be fruitless in his providence. A season of empty nets that will teach you that you can't do it and you must rely on Jesus, whether it's at school or at home, at work, in relationships, whatever that is. And if that is true at a personal level, you better believe it's true at the gospel level. Even if as a church goes through a period of empty nets, even as individuals, as disciples of Jesus who are fishing for men and women and boys and girls, even if we've gone through a season where it's discouraging, no one is listening, no one is responding. Every time I try to speak about Jesus, I get ignored or shut down. I've become discouraged or even embarrassed, or I've become silent with empty nets. Remember, after we repotted Bannockburn a few years back, maybe, and then that followed what with a couple of years of a pandemic. Maybe that's how we felt with empty nets, you know, doing church online, mandates and restrictions on and off and on and off. And there was this sense and feeling that our nets are empty, hearts feeling discouraged. And yet, when in that season, God says, let down your nets. Are you willing to do it? Are you willing to do it at work and with your colleagues or your customers, at home, with your spouses or your kids, at playgroup, with your friends and your neighbors, at school, with students or teachers, wherever opportunity that you have, maybe in localities like North Geelong, or maybe even if God told us to let down our nets in Lara, would you do it? Would you say, at your word, Lord? Even if up until that point, your nets are empty. Because that's how you grow gospel resilience. Because the command comes with a promise. We must let down our nets. And Christ has reminded us there will be a catch. Because the one who said, go and make disciples, is also the one who said, I will build my church and the gates of Hades will not prevail. Amen. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for this picture of discipleship in Luke 5. We confess, because we are people of faith, that we fall short of this. We hesitate at times to obey your word. We're happy in season to do it, but out of season, in a period of empty nets, our resilience just dissipates and our discouragement speaks louder than your word and your promises, and we're reluctant to put down our nets. Oh, grow us in our faith. Strengthen our faith. Grant to us repentance where we have not used our resources and our platforms for the Lord Jesus Christ, where we've kept our money or our sex lives or our reputations or our hobbies or our homes or our finances, and we've kept them separate from our Christian lives, sanctified them for our own use. Oh, we pray that this gospel picture would challenge us, that the way of flourishing is trusting the King. And even if everything around us tells us it's not going to work and our nets are going to be empty, but at your word. And so like Peter, we repent. We ask for your forgiveness and we ask for that grace that will allow us to have lives that are responsive to the word of God, that they will produce much fruit, that our marriages and our homes and our relationships and our churches might flourish as we follow the King. And we might be astonished ourselves at the catch that might follow. So hear our prayers. Forgive our sins and strengthen our faith, because we ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, we're going to respond two ways. One, we're going to bring our free will offering. So if you're visiting or you're just a guest today, please just let the offering bags go past as an act of worship for the Lord's people. And as we do that, we're going to sing a song. We sang it the first time last week, a bit tricky. God loved the world so, and we're going to sing it again. But we've got our A-team singing this week, so you'll be able to lead us through that. So let's stand and we'll sing. As the gospel response is, let's sing together, God so loved the world.
God's people belong to one another, and we belong to Jesus Christ. He belongs to us, and God's people have always prayed. They've always prayed when they meet together, and that's what we're going to do now, and I'm going to lead you now in what we call our pastoral prayer, when we pray for the gospel and we pray for one another. Let's pray together, please. Father in heaven, we thank you that we have such a Savior, Lord, that though he was rich, yet for our sake he became poor, so that by his poverty we might become rich. We thank you, Father, that he gave and he gave and he gave himself to extremists, to the point of death, so that we might have our sins forgiven and that we might be adopted into your kingdom and become your children, your sons and your daughters, and we might one day reign with you in heaven alongside our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. We know these things in part. We are enriched by them, but in ages to come, they will eternally be our experience, and we will eternally experience the riches of the love of God and understand its length and breadth and height and depth. And this great joy we have before us, Father, we have sinned, but we have such a Savior that all our sins are freely forgiven. And we appreciate that. We love you for that. We acknowledge you as our Lord and as our Savior and the only one to whom we owe loyalty and our trust and our faith. We confess Jesus. We certainly do. And we say, Abba, Father, as your children. And we want to thank you, Father, for we have much to be thankful for. We have been enriched in many ways, and you have richly provided with food, with work, family, good health. We have the church, we have one another, we have the Bible in which we may read and be reminded of your rich promises, and most particularly, you have enriched our souls. You have delivered us from being mean-spirited, self-aggrandizing, manipulative, selfish, and you have made us like your Son, not in whole, but in part. The work you are doing, you are bringing to completion. We acknowledge that, Father, but we have been nevertheless enriched greatly in our souls. Thank you for that, and we pray and we would ask that you would continue that work. We want to pray, Lord, for the gospel. We want to pray for preachers in Australia and around the world who on this day, the Lord's Day, who take the word of God, that precious seed. We pray and ask that they would sow it well. We pray that their messages would be rich in the word of God, rich in the promises of God, rich in the gospel of repentance and salvation, rich in the hope of Christ and in the world to come. And we would ask, Lord, that the word of God would prove to be taking captive the souls of men and breaking down every thought raised up against him and bringing men into his kingdom. We pray, Lord, that would run into the hearts of men. We pray that you grant grace to men and women, boys and girls, to listen. Grant them ears to hear, as our Savior said many times, listen. We pray, Lord, that you'd open up men's souls to receive and hear the word of God, and that men and women, boys and girls, would be saved on this day, Father, or in the days ahead, as the word of God has been sown into their hearts and into their souls. We would ask for the gospel work here in Geelong, at Bannockburn, and on the Bellarine Peninsula, Geelong West, and at Inverlee, and here at North Geelong. We pray, Father, that our churches might grow, that you'd bring the lost within our walls and they'd hear the word of God and that they would be saved. We pray for our gospel work that we're planning to do in Lara. Father, we ask, Lord, that you would be in this, not merely the plans of men, but that you would be at work in this. Grant us grace, Father. Grant us courage. Grant us faith to let down our nets. Prosper this work. Prosper our plans. Bring it together, Father. We would ask, Lord, that you would be kind to work through us, to build your kingdom, to extend its dominion to the souls of men and women. We pray for the lost. We pray for those who, at this moment, they are slaves to their appetites. We pray, Lord, that you would bring them into your kingdom. Some men today, some men and women, are reading the Bible. It's been given to them by a friend or a family, or they've picked one up, or they've just suddenly decided to read that Bible they were given at school by the, I can't remember the group. But anyway, they read the Bible, Father. We pray, Lord, that you would bless them as they read the Bible and grant them understanding. Some people today are reading books about the Christian faith. They're reading books that tell them about your world and the world that you've made, and tell them and to try to explain the Bible and the gospel. Father, bless them. Grant them understanding of what they're reading and bring them into your kingdom. We pray for your people, Lord, who suffer, your Christian people who suffer under war and are at the hand of brutal men, men made brutal by war. Protect them, Father. Grant them faith for the day. We pray for those that suffer injustice, where they are ruled over by men who are themselves ruled over by love of money and power. Grant them your grace. Keep them safe. We pray for those that are wearied and laid down by sickness. Grant them patience, Father, and restore their strength and your help, particularly the strength and the health of their soul. We pray for those that walk in darkness and have no light. Father, we pray you'd shine the light of the gospel into their hearts. We pray for Richard and Sylvia as they have continued to wait long days, Father, long, long days for that operation. We pray that it would take place as it has been promised in about a week from now. And Lord, it would be a great blessing. We pray that it would be underdone successfully and there'd be a tremendously good outcome for Sylvia. Grant them your grace. Grant them patience. We pray for the Currys. Thank you, Lord, that they are able to shift into their new home. We pray that it would be a blessing to them and a gospel blessing too. And thank you for all those that labored to assist them in that move. And now we commend ourselves to you and to your mercy. We thank you, Lord, that the God of peace will soon crush Satan under our feet. Thank you, Father. We commend ourselves to you and to your mercy. In Jesus' name, amen. And now we're going to stand and confess our faith together. Is that right, Darren? Lord's Supper. And then we'll confess our faith in song.
Just invite the elders to come forward. Well, we've been hearing from God's word. The word presents the gospel to us, and what you get in the sacraments is you get a picture of the gospel. And just as God has spoken to us about what it looks like to follow him and the anticipation and expectation that our lives will be offered up to Jesus, it is modeled in the fact that God himself offered up his life for us. And what you get in this sacrament is this picture that this is how God has loved the world. How did God love the world? He gave his only begotten son so his body would be broken for you, that he would die for your sins and for your transgressions, for your disobedience, for your half-heartedness, for your failings. And he would take all that sin and that guilt and that shame and he would nail it to a cross. So it was finished. It was done. And that's what we're celebrating today. That's why this is a profession of faith. And so if you are a Christian this morning, this is for you. You should eat and drink, not because you're perfect, because you're not, but he is. Not because you're good, because he's good. Not because you're sold on Jesus, it's because he's laid down everything for you. And if you have saving faith, then you should eat and drink this morning. And as you do, not only will you profess your faith, you can be reminded again and afresh that even though I'm always falling short of Jesus, his blood is sufficient for me. And therefore you should eat and drink and rejoice. And while this is a gracious gospel invitation, it also comes with a warning, because Paul writes about that. He warns those who might eat and drink in an unworthy manner. In the context of Corinthians, it's disunity, but an unworthy manner would be any unconfessed sin or one who does not have a saving faith in Christ. And so my encouragement to you this morning, each and every one of you, is we're going to take an opportunity to pray. If you're a Christian, eat and drink, but just make sure you do it with repentance and faith. And if you're not a Christian, don't eat and drink, because the gospel gives a warning that if you eat and drink in an unworthy manner, that you eat and drink judgment on yourself. The best solution for you, if you're not a Christian, is to repent of your sin and put your hope in the one who has given his life as a ransom for many. So we're going to have that opportunity to do that together. So let's pray. I'll lead you in that prayer, and then we'll eat and drink together in memory of him. Our great God, we thank you for this picture of the gospel that is set before us. And the gospel is always a gracious invitation, an encouragement of people to come to Jesus. And we would do that now. We would do that in faith. We would do it with repentance. We would do it knowing that you've shed your blood for us, and ask of you, our Lord Jesus Christ, that you would take away our sin, take away our failures, take away the transgressions of half-heartedness, take away our feeling that we're not good enough, and remind us again that our identity is tethered to Jesus, and that your obedience is ours, and through your work on the cross, it is now our salvation and blessing. And if there are any amongst us, Lord, who have not come to that point where they have bent their knee before Jesus the King, where they have not as yet confessed their sin and their need for Christ as their Lord and Saviour, oh, how we pray that you would grant them no rest, no peace, no joy until they find it in him. And if it would please you, be gracious to them and grant them even now, this hour, repentance and faith in your Son, so that all of us, as we eat and drink, might do it with your divine blessing upon us. For we ask all these things in Jesus' name. Well, on the night the Lord Jesus was betrayed, he took bread and he broke it, saying, "This is my body given for you. Do this whenever you eat it in remembrance of me." in remembrance of Jesus. In the same manner, after supper, the Lord Jesus took the cup, saying, "This is the cup of the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." Till he comes again. Eternal Father, we thank you that in your Son you have lavished divine love upon us. We thank you that your promises have become an anchor for our soul and the joy of our salvation. We thank you that whatever weakness and transgressions there are in us, that in Christ there is righteousness and joy and hope and renewal. Oh, so fill us with your Spirit even now. Fill us so that we, as men and women and boys and girls of Christ Jesus, that we might know that we have been loved in your Son, and that as we respond to the gospel, that we will give of ourselves entirely at your word, a people who at your word will drop down our nets and serve you. To this end, bless us, encourage us, and strengthen us. For we ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, let's conclude our worship. We're going to do that. We're seeing what is, again, another profession of our faith. This was a public profession. We're going to conclude it with singing "This I Believe," which is essentially the Apostles' Creed to song. Your friends, lift up your hearts, receive the blessing, the gospel blessing of our Lord Jesus Christ. Now may the grace and the love and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit rest and abide with each and every one of you. In the name of Jesus, amen.